Jesse, you know, in psychiatry, we learned something called adverse childhood experiences. And we call them ACEs, adverse childhood experiences. And
yeah, I just learned about this.
Yeah, there you go. So, and what we learn is that if children under the age of 17, and you were 9, experience trauma, experience violence, experience substance abuse, observed, and a lot of other things, there's so much more likelihood that they're going to develop issues growing up. And what we notice as psychiatrists is people develop their own coping strategies to deal with this. And unfortunately, sometimes our coping strategies aren't the greatest, right? People drink, or they'll do drugs, or they'll try and numb themselves out, or, you know, a whole bunch of other things. And sometimes people can choose better coping strategies. But what did you do when you were growing up with this and you were dealing with this? What was your coping strategy? How did you deal with all of this trauma?
There were no resources available for a child in my position. So there was no, you know, support group that I could go to where family members are infamous now, or gun violence. And so I never processed my trauma. I just kept my head going, and I kept succeeding and achieving and being the lead of the school play and getting an A+ on every test. And eventually, I did not receive therapy. I was extremely stubborn. I had my own personal stigma against it. I was already labeled this, you know, insanely different person. And now, like, oh, and now I'm crazy? I don't think so. And so I sat there like this. And then the terms was, okay, but if we see you slipping, you're going to have to go back to therapy. And so that's when I was like, I'm fine for the rest of my life, whether I was or not. And so once I got a little older and started experimenting with drugs and alcohol, and I realized that it just took me away from all the insanity. It took my fear away. It took my panic away. It took my anxiety away. Because I was running around with a lot of fear and anxiety. Fear that someone's going to come out of the blue and shoot me in the face. You know, fear that someone's going to say something about my dad and I'm not going to know what to say back, or my feelings are going to get hurt. So I never learned to regulate my emotions.
That's a recurrent theme we talk about, that when you've had trauma at any point and you don't address that trauma, you don't deal with it. And what it usually takes is therapy of some kind. I mean, this really leads to problems.
Yeah, and that's why so many people like Jesse turn to substances, because what substances do, I mean, we know this, they just numb you out, because it's so hard to feel everything that you're feeling, all those negative emotions that she's experiencing and explaining so well, that you numb yourself out. But the problem with that is twofold. Is one, you're not getting to the root of anything.
Nope.
And number two, when you're sober, it smacks you back in the face and it reminds you how unhappy and scared and frightened you are. You know,
yes.
So this, honestly, Jesse, by definition, this is like post-traumatic stress. How does this affect your relationships?
What relationships? You know what? It's affected every relationship, from friends to family to intimate relationships. I have an insanely tough time trusting anybody, because I'm just either afraid, A, I'm going to get shot if I fall in love. And these are early wires and we're trying to rewire them, I know, but these are the tapes that play in my head, that if I fall in love and everything looks fine, I still might get shot in the head. Or if I have sex with somebody and someone catches me and puts it on videotape, they're going to sell it to the National Enquirer and exploit me for it. Or are you friends with me because you're friends with me, or you say you went to Joey Buttafuoco's house? But I've never been in love. I've never had the desire to necessarily even go down that path, just because of my survival instincts are, don't do that because you're probably going to get killed or exploited.
Right. And look, with post-traumatic stress and everything you've dealt with, what happened to you, Jesse, is that the way I explain it, is, if this makes sense, hopefully, is like your thermostat has been reset to super sensitive, because your mind and body does not want to go back to any of that trauma. So you're protecting yourself. You've built this castle around who you are. So imagine you're very, very guarded with relationships. And of course, you don't want to let anybody in, because there's no way you're going to let somebody make you feel the way that you felt as a child in your adolescence and your young adulthood, right? The trick here, and you know this, is to be okay with some vulnerability.
Yeah. Vulnerability has become my strongest asset, not only for my own healing, but also to connect with others. I've been doing some group therapy and support groups, and hearing other people's story of adversity also helps me connect with people on such a different real level, and has really been revolutionary in my relationships. So absolutely.